one with the communion of saints in all times and places. Let us confess our sin against God and one another. O God, our merciful Redeemer, we confess the ways we live only for ourselves. We fail to see you in our neighbor's face. We turn our ears from voices that cry out. We pass by the hungry and the oppressed. In your great mercy, forgive our sin and strengthen us for the service to all in need, through Jesus Christ our Lord. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for you, and for his sake, God forgives you all your sin. Blessed you are. Rejoice and be glad, beloved people of God. We sing our opening hymn, which is 511. 511, and I think the choir, the honors choir, is going to sing the first stanza. And we'll join with the attendees which follow.
Time.
Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Save me.
aha, and gloat over me, turn back because of their shame. But as for me, I am poor and needy. Come to me quickly, O God. You are my helper and my deliverer, O Lord. Do not tarry. The second reading is from 1 Thessalonians. We do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about those who have died, so that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, though Jesus, God will bring with him those who have died. For this we declare to you, by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will by no means precede those who have died. For the Lord himself, with a cry of command, with the archangel's call, and with the sound of God's trumpet, will descend from heaven, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up in the clouds together with them to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. Word of God, word of God.
I said, I'm sure that in just a few moments, the
The groom is going to be here and the service will be started. So just hang on. Would you believe it? 30 minutes later, the guy showed up with his best man. And they were walking straight. Their words weren't swearing. I still would like to know why they didn't make it on time for his wedding. When they finally were all ready to go, we stepped out into the congregation, and the congregation gave him a loud round of applause. And rightly so. The story that's told in Matthew, the 25th chapter, the story that Jesus told, is very much like this groom who came late to the wedding banquet. We kind of gather from history and looking behind the text that it was not uncommon because, you see, the groom and part of his family would go to the bride, and there were family issues. There were sensitive financial issues that had to be worked out before finally the bride was given over to the groom. So sometimes it could go very quickly, and sometimes it took a long time to get all those negotiations done. That's the situation behind our gospel reading today. And we find out that finally the groom and the bride come, and everybody wakes up, and those who were sleeping, they woke up, and they wanted to use some oil for their lamps because they knew that theirs were going out, and were told that they went into town to get more oil. But everybody else who had been waiting for the bride and the groom, they went into the banquet, the door was closed, and the party began. What an awesome story, it really is. And some of you may be wondering, like different times I wondered too, why did Jesus tell this story? Why do we need to hear that story today? Does it have any implication to how you and I live our lives? You know, life can be such where we just kind of float along and we do things, but Jesus was very clear. Jesus just didn't talk off the top of his head. Jesus told this story because, as he said, watch and be aware, for you do not know when the Son of Man will come back. So that's the warning to us. We need to be prepared for the coming of the Lord. We need to wake up. We need to get everything into action that one day soon, everything will come to an end, and we'll be gathered together with the Lord God. And we need to always remember that the real emphasis of this story is that the wedding banquet is joyous. There's great celebration, great joy when God's people at the end of times will be gathered together. That's the hope we hang on to today. If you've been reading your papers or if you've been watching TV, you know there's a lot of stuff going on behind that hashtag called MeToo. A lot of women and some men have been voicing their great pain in their hearts and their lives, where they've been harassed, abused, taken advantage of. They've lived through painful experiences, and many times in silence. The old ancient sins of lust and greed and power have taken over for so many people, and so many others have been trampled down and kept quiet. There's a lot of people today shouting with the prophet Amos when Amos said to the sinful people long ago, "Let justice roll down like waters, and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream." That's the great cry that I hear, and I think you do too. Let the waters, the mighty waters, roll down. God's justice needs to come and be among us. One other ancient sin needs to be held up, especially within the Christian church, besides lust, greed, and power. And that's the old ancient sin called sloth. That we very seldom use that word today, but behind that word is the emphasis of being lazy, apathetic. I'm not really getting too excited about anything, just kind of floating along. It's the attitude where we say, well, I can't do anything about it, so what difference does it make? My little voice won't make a difference, so I'll just keep quiet. I won't rock the cage. Sloth is a serious, serious problem for the Christian church, along with other ancient sins. In fact, these old ancient sins have plagued our watchfulness for the coming of the Lord God. So that's why we need to take heart when Jesus says, you don't know the hour or the day when the Son of Man will be coming back again. I have a friend who had a very serious heart attack. Surgery, rehab, and was recovering. And sometime later, and this is what my friend told me. Pastor Warren, that heart attack was a wake-up call for me. I wasn't eating right. I spent too many hours working. My priorities in life were out of kilter. Sad to say, I wasn't right with my family and with the Lord God. Today, I see every day as a gift from God. With God's help, I'm learning to trust the Lord one day at a time. Those are good words, wise words for all of us. Watch out, be ready. You don't know when the hour will come, when you'll be gathered with the Lord God. In recent months, a number of catastrophes have plagued our country. I think of the hurricanes that went through Texas and Florida, Puerto Rico, and the other islands. I think of the fires out in California and the West Coast. Devastating. Think of the mass shootings. It has left a lot of us kind of nervous and anxious. What's coming next? What's going to happen? What do we need to do? I'm encouraged because there are some wise people saying that all of us, as citizens, as people, need to have a safety plan put in place. So if a crisis came and we had to leave home, the family and loved ones would know where we will meet and where they can reach us. A safety plan. And you need to have a go-to bag that you carry with you. You have a plan and you have this bag which is filled with documents, prescriptions, medications, simple things like water, all very important. In our day, we need to be prepared for the unexpected. It happens all the time. So it is with our relationship with God. We can't take that for granted. It's not just something we can kind of just say, well, okay, I sure hope I'm with the Lord at the very end. No, we've got to be watchful. We've got to be aware. We've got to be prepared. In the prayer of the day that we pray to begin the service, there was this prayer, Lord God of justice and love, give us the light we need. Give us the light we need. Every one of us need God's light within our heads, our hearts, and our minds. All of us need to know how to live on grace time. Each day is a gift, so don't squander it as if all of us are doing it. Every day is grace time, a gift. Honor it, cherish it. Sure, there are days when everything goes helter-skelter. Some days we hurt, we're angry, we're mad. But keep the focus on the Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord God. Keep in mind that promise that the Lord God is our hope and our refuge. So regardless of what we're going through, that awaits us, a hope, a promise that carries us through difficult times. Through the life and death and resurrection of Christ, we are good angel friends. So claim God's promise. So we pray, Lord, give us the life we need and awaken in us the needs of others. Awaken in us the needs of others. A couple of weeks ago, there was a nice dinner that my wife and I attended. It was a wonderful meal at noon. Food was just sumptuous to all get out. And the one who served the meals was a lady by the name Sue. And she also gave a little talk after the meal. And her talk kind of centered on this thought, that all that we do, all that we eat, all our food should always be a continuation of Jesus feeding the 5,000. The whole theme is that we have food, and it always tastes the best when we can share it with others. Would you agree? Thanksgiving is at its best when it can be shared with family, yes, and friends. So that's why Sue, who lives kind of in southern Wisconsin, once a week, she packs up her van and goes into Chicago at night to the Humboldt Park area, one of the industrial areas. And she's a part of what they call it's a ministry that meets to people who don't have food and don't have the basic necessities of life. She's a part of that ministry, and she kind of says, this is part of the way I can pass on my love to other people. That Jesus loves them, Jesus loved me, therefore I'm going to share with other people. So friends, that's a good prayer to pray. Lord, give us your wisdom. Help us to be awakened to what you need and what to share with us. There's a chorus that I know that the people of Zion love to sing. It's called Soon, Very Soon. The words go something like this. Soon, very soon, we're going to see the King. Soon, very soon, we're going to see the King. Soon, very soon, we're going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. The next stanza is, no more crying there. The next stanza is, no more dying there. And the final stanza is, soon we're going to see the King. What a good song to kind of pull together our service today. That's a good news for our day. Jesus Christ will be returning soon. Together the party, the strong, the faithful ones. And God willing, you and me, and all God's people. And the question always will be, are we ready to join the Lord in the party? Amen. One of the great joys of the Christian church is to celebrate baptism. And so today, we just need to say how special it is for our congregation, for Zion Lutheran and the family and all of us to be witnesses and part of the baptism of your daughter and your son. Paul.
In holy baptism, our gracious Heavenly Father frees us from sin and death by joining us to the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. We are born children of the fallen humanity. By water and the Holy Spirit, we are reborn children of God and made members of the church, the body of Christ. Living with Christ and in the communion of saints, we grow in faith, love, and obedience to the will of God.
Teresa Jeffrey. As you bring your children to receive the gift of baptism, you are entrusted with these responsibilities: to live with them among God's faithful people, bring them to worship, to hear the word of God, and receive Holy Communion. Teach them the Lord's Prayer, the Creed, the Ten Commandments. Place in their hands the Holy Scriptures, and read the Bible to them. Nurture them in faith and prayer, so that your children may learn to trust God, proclaim Christ through word and deed. Care for others and the world God made, and work for justice and peace. Do you promise to help your children grow in faith and life?
We do, and ask God to help us.
I ask all of you to profess your faith in Christ Jesus, reject sin, and confess the faith of the church, the faith in which we baptize. Do you renounce all the forces of evil, the devil, and all the forces that defy God?
I do.
Do you believe in God the Father?
Yeah, it's cold. E.J., I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. We give you thanks, O God, that through water and the Holy Spirit, you give new life, cleansing us from sin and raising us up to new life. Pour your Holy Spirit upon E.J. and Gina, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and life, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the Spirit of joy in your presence. Amen. E.J. and Gina, children of God, you've been sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever. Amen.
For the sake of the one who took on our nature and form
to redeem the whole world. Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Through baptism, God has made each AMG members of the ministry we all share in Christ Jesus. I ask you, the people of God, will you support their parents and sponsors and work with them as a team to help lay down a faith foundation in the life of each AMG, that they would desire to be disciples of Jesus Christ?
Yes.
Each AMG, we welcome you into the body of Christ and into the mission of being equal saved, sharing the grace of Christ with all. We receive you as fellow members of the body of Christ, children of the same Heavenly Father, and children of Christ in the family of God. Amen. Let us welcome EJ and Gia into God's family and our brother and sister in Christ. Put the next round of applause. The peace of the Lord be with you all. Let us pray about peace around you.
I guess we're going to need a week for Monday. She preaches next Sunday.
bring forth bread from the earth and fruit from the vine. Nourish us with these gifts, that we might be for the world signs of your gracious presence, in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Just a word of instruction regarding Holy Communion. All are welcome who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, are welcome to come and receive the sacrament. We will gather around the communion rail for our sacrament today and receive the body of the Lord Christ. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, for the glorious resurrection of our Savior, Jesus Christ, the true Paschal Lamb, who gave himself to take away our sin, who in dying had destroyed death, and in rising had brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, and with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join your ending hymn.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Life-giving God, in the mystery of Christ's resurrection, you sent light to conquer darkness, water to give new life, and the bread of life to nourish your people. Send us forth as witnesses to your Son's resurrection, that we may show your glory to all the world. Through Jesus Christ, our risen Lord.
Amen.
Wait. We'd like to thank the Rockford Lutheran High School Art Choir and the Rebecca Mitchell. So the Jackson family, we wish you God's blessing as you go back to the state of Washington. Our thoughts and prayers be with you. So always come back and visit us. We will sing now our final blessing. First and last stanza, Guide Me, Ever Great Redeemer. First and last stanza.